Morris Doriel was born Claude Doggins of Sulphur Springs, Oklahoma in 1898. D. 1963, he looked more like a feed store owner or small-town banker than the guru he became to his thousand or so followers. He founded his Brotherhood of the White Temple in 1929, naming it after a group of masters of the same name often invoked by Helena P. Blavatsky's successor Annie Besant, the New Age Theosophical leader, Branton. He claimed that after serving in the First World War, he traveled to Tibet and spent 8 years studying there with the Dalai Lama. The last organization I was able to find that related themselves to the White Brotherhood was the Brotherhood of the White Temple. This brotherhood claims to again have its origins from mystical and divine sources. Their teachings are based upon the translations of the Emerald Tablets of Tot, not to be confused with the Emerald Tablet of Hermes. The tablets were translated by Dr. Doriel. Dr. Doriel has a connection with the Great White Lodge or mystic masters that presumably exist upon the ethereal planes. The tablets themselves are said to be created by Tot the Atlantean from a substance made from alchemical experimentation. His writings consist of 12 tablets of emerald green formed from a substance created through alchemical transmutation. They are imperishable, resistant to all elements, corrosion and acids. In effect, the atomic and cellular structure is fixed, and no change can take place, thus violating the material law of ionization. Upon them are engraved characters in the ancient Atlantean language, characters which respond to the attuned thought waves of the reader and which release much more wisdom and information than the characters do when merely deciphered. The tablets are fastened together with hoops of a golden-colored alloy suspended from a rod of the same material. Now this can mean one of two things. The first is that Dr. Doriel is in fact fictitious and started his own cult. After all, the Brotherhood is on over 1,500 acres in Colorado. Or it could in fact mean that Dr. Doriel is of the Great White Brotherhood. Given his description and the description of the tablets could very well be a high possibility. Regardless, it seems that the famed White Brotherhood of Esoterica remains intangible. The Brotherhood holds as much realism and esteem as Santa Claus, or the Easter Bunny. That is to say, it is probably only a dream. However, since the true brotherhood is said to exist in higher dimensions, we were damned from the start to never find empirical evidence. Doriel published a series of pamphlets, called The Little Temple Library, on a wide variety of occult-related topics from Atlantis to UFOs. He have gained his knowledge from his contact with the Great White Lodge of Masters, those who have passed beyond their earthly experience and now seek to guide humanity in its evolution. As redundant backup around the world in secure places there are left the authentic ancient Hermetic texts, attributed it to the Atlantean priest King Tot who wrote it 36,000 years ago. Claude Doggins aka Morris Doriel was the author of booklets Mysteries of Mount Shasta, Mysteries of the Gobi, Polar Paradise, and similar published by the Brotherhood of the White Temple Incorporated in Sedalia, Colorado. Mysteries of Mount Shasta. In a 1946 interview with a reporter from the Rocky Mountain News, Doriel said, "I had predicted atomic war years before it came. I saw atomic energy at work several years ago when the Dalai Lama of Tibet ushered me into the Great White Lodge 75 miles under the Himalayas. If by any chance this is true, he is probably referring to a tunnel 75 miles long." Branton, in his writings, Doriel claimed to have visited many of the retreats of the masters. In Mysteries of Mount Shasta, Doriel revealed that he was privileged to pay a visit in the flesh to the Atlantean Knot Lemurian, he wrote, as is commonly believed colony inside Mount Shasta. As he told it, while he was in Los Angeles delivering a series of occult lectures, two of the Shasta masters walked up to him after one lecture and introduced themselves. In February 1953, the Denver Post reported that the city of Telos below the Mount Shasta. They drove up to Topanga Canyon, a favorite locale for paranormal activities in Los Angeles, parked the car, climbed a hill, and the masters took strange belts and cellophane masks from their pockets, giving Doriel one of each. He put on the mask and was instructed to push certain buttons on the belt. When he did, all three rose into the air, into a waiting UFO, or were they supposedly wearing some type of anti-gravity belt, Branton, and 15 minutes or so later they landed on the side of Shasta. They entered a small concealed stone building which carried them like a trolley to the top of the mountain, where they stepped out onto a great flat rock. The rack was a hidden elevator, and it began descending rapidly until it reached a point 5 miles within the mountain and far below sea level. They left the elevator, passed through two great pillars made of orichalcum, the shining white metal known only to the Atlanteans, entered another elevator, and ascended 2 more miles. At last Doriel found himself in an enormous cavern about 20 miles long and 15 miles wide, and it was as light as a bright summer day, because suspended, almost in the center of that great cavern of space was a giant glowing mass of light. They told me later that it was condensed from a blending of the rays of the sun and moon and that it had all of the harmful rays, no doubt referring to the radiation rays, Branton, in it extracted and only the life-giving and beneficial energies left. Note, the city of Telos is said to be only 1 mile below the surface of Mount Shasta and not nearly as large as the ones Doriel describes. However, UFOlogist Lucius Farish tells of a strange old sea hermit he knew of who claimed to have met human-like beings while on the peak of Mount Shasta, beings who claimed to live in huge caverns in the lower crust, deep below sea level, which can be entered via openings along the edge of the so-called Pacific Ring of Fire region of which Mount Shasta and the Cascade Range is a part. This man, who went by the nickname Harmonious, being the fisherman that he was, claimed that these people took him on rides to other planets in clamshell-shaped vessels. He also learned that, like many native African, Atlantic and South American tribes, these people went about naked in their underground habitat, most likely due to the stable and warm environment which negated the need for protective clothing, Branton. This light was collected by three powerhouses hidden on the mountain which purified the light and expelled the waste matter as colored rays. So when Larkin and Lancer, two well-known early California astronomers who actually claimed that they had seen pearly-domed structures hidden among the foliage and cliffs high up the slope of Shasta, Branton, saw those mysterious lights emanating from the mountain just before sunrise, they were seeing the Shasta masters ridding themselves of the harmful solar and lunar rays. Doriel described the Atlantean city inside Shasta as one of beautiful homes of white marble surrounded by gardens of flowers, vegetables, and fruits. The forebears of many had been saved from the sinking of Atlantis, or a similar post-diluvian island continent which sank. It is interesting that Plato was familiar with the location and destruction of Atlantis. The transmuter device. The Atlantean projectoscope. The Atlanteans knew how to turn sand into gold, and how to make clothing by simply drawing a picture of the garment they desired. The drawing was placed in a projectoscope which displayed the actual garment on the screen. When it fell to the floor, it was ready to wear. Note, obviously, many of the claims of occultists like Maurice Doriel, Raymond Bernard, Robert Dickhoff, the Heferlins, et al., the latter of which are mentioned later in this chapter, are highly influenced and embroidered by their own wishful thinking and imagination. It is common for people who claim to have encountered alien realms, not discounting the possibility that such encounters have occurred, to fill in certain unanswered areas of their stories with answers of their own devising, and their own pet theories of supernatural beliefs which they pass off as information gathered from the others. Often they rely on information channeled from supernatural sources, which usually leads them deeper into confusion, self-contradiction and ridicule, and away from tangible and provable facts. Whether this description of the transmuter device is such an elaboration is uncertain. He concluded his description of the subterranean city by reminding his readers that one could enter Shasta only when invited. The seeker who was not ready, but who tried to find the city anyway, might step into a space warp and find himself 5 miles away from where he wanted to be. but the masters knew instantly of anyone approaching who is in the right state of conscience, and they can pass into the inner temples. The evil Lemurians. The Atlanteans, like the other groups of masters, served the cosmic plan by protecting us from forces we were not yet ready to use. Near the end of his letter to Palmer, Doriel emphasized, "I do know that the race Mr. Shaver calls Darrow exists, although I know them under another name." Perhaps he was referring to a group of Lemurian priest kings and nobles whom he later wrote were kept prisoners in huge cities they had built beneath what is now the Caroline Islands. These evil Lemurians were held underground by a special team of 353 Atlanteans who traveled back and forth from their Shasta headquarters by spaceship because the Lemurians had discovered a destructive force far worse than the atomic bomb, one that would mean the end of the human race if it was revealed to us. Note, a man by the name of Galahadian once wrote into Esoteric World News in the mid-1980s and stated that the people below Mount Shasta were Darrow, whereas those who inhabited the so-called Atlantean caverns below the eastern coast are often referred to in the same derogatory way by the so-called Lemurians at Shasta and elsewhere, as if there are two underground groups attempting to label each other as being members of this degenerate classification. Branton. The Star Antares. Doriel did believe that although the ultimate headquarters of the Great White Brotherhood is on the Star Antares of the Pleiades, whatever the masters taught Doriel, they neglected astronomy. Antares is a star in the constellation Scorpio, not the Pleiades. Captain Minkle, there are seven subterranean places of retreat for the masters in this world. Six of them are located. 1. In the Gobi Desert. 2. In the Atlas Mountains of North Africa. 3. In the Northwest Territories of Canada. 4. Beneath the ruins of a Mayan city in Yucatan. 5. In the Harz Mountains of Germany, and 6. Within Shasta. 7. The seventh and most important of these retreats is Shambhala, located beneath Lhasa, the capital of Tibet. The same name is also given by Asian occultists to a supposed astral or aerial city above the Gobi Desert, although Shambhala or Shambhala is also supposed to be the name of the capital city of the Kingdom of Agartha or Agartha according to Nicholas Roerich and others. Branton. Some 75 miles beneath, 75-mile-long tunnel, Branton, the Himalayas, Shambhala is protected from curious and malicious outsiders by a space warp. In the 1946 Rocky Mountain News interview, Doriel called Shambhala the center of all the occult lore of this planet and said that in the cavern housing Shambhala, as in the cavern that housed the Shasta colony, suspended, without apparent support, above the temple is a mighty globe of radioactive material. Around it shimmers a mist of opalescent light allowing only the life-saving and life-bearing rays to emanate. Seeing the might of these rays was Doriel's introduction to atomic power. In fact, the Swiss contactee Edward Billy Meyer claims that his Nordic Pleiaden contacts have the ability to transport a person aboard their craft in a similar fashion as depicted in Star Trek, and also possess androids of a sentient nature and awareness similar to that of Data in the Star Trek series, although rather than being individuals these androids like Data would actually be extensions of the minds and personalities of those who created them. Branton. Doriel's Shambhala, like Blavatsky and Ballard's, Guy Ballard that is, the former leader of the Mount Shasta-based I Am cult, Branton, underground retreats, contained a library of everything mankind ever did or ever would do. Like the spools of golden ribbon Saint Germain, allegedly, showed Ballard, the books in Shambhala's library consisted of spools of fine wire, each spool no larger than my little finger, and each was supplied with a tiny motor the size of a fingernail. By pushing certain buttons, the wire would flow past a crystal very slowly, and when the user looked into the crystal, pictures of the past would appear, like a videotape in miniature. When another button was pushed, the sound or narration came on, and if the spool was turned sideways, a three-dimensional image appeared in space about 10 feet away. The Serpent People. A vaguely humanoid race. Captain Minkle then describes one supposed series of recorded events which the ancient crystallographic computers revealed. What is now Antarctica was the home of the Serpent People, a vaguely humanoid race with heads like a great snake and their bodies faintly scaled as, with, the scales of a serpent. Since the two races, the Serpent Race and the Human Giants, that is, according to Doriel, although it was not specified whether these alleged events were supposed to have taken place in antediluvian or post-diluvian times, Branton, were utterly different in mind as well as in form. They did not understand each other at all. War broke out between them. The Serpent People possessed hypnotic powers which allowed them to appear human to the sons of God and their other human allies, and they frequently passed among them as spies. Note, this term sons of God is interpreted by some theologians as being a reference to the righteous sons of Seth as opposed to the corrupted daughters of Cain in antediluvian times, even though some have mistakenly referred to the sons of God who lived on earth before the flood as being either angels or giants. Actually, there are no indications in the Holy Bible that angelic spirits can physically reproduce themselves, and as for the giants, the book of Genesis says they did exist before the flood, many believing they lived on Lemuria, which may have connected at the time with the western part of North America, but these sons of God gave birth to the race of giants, although it is not certain whether they were giants themselves. Some have supposed that the original Adamic race was much taller in stature than modern man, perhaps twice more so, though even of this there are few indications in the Judeo-Christian writings whether this was so. Branton, the humans developed a trick that could identify a serpent person immediately. The guards in the human cities and fortifications required all those entering to pronounce the word kininigen. Doriel didn't say what kininigen meant, but it was a serpent person's undoing, for that word could only be pronounced by human vocal cords. In a lush kingdom that is now the Gobi Desert, however, there lives at that time a blonde, blue-eyed race of humans who had developed a super weapon to use against the Serpent People, a weapon so powerful they did not know its full potential. But they pointed it at the land of the Serpent People and set it off, unleashing a catastrophe that almost destroyed the world. The earth toppled to one side, Doriel wrote, came out of balance, began to wobble, and as it did so, great volcanoes broke, mountains were pushed up, and other land masses sank beneath the waters. The Serpent People were wiped out. Those at home in Antarctica quickly froze to death, for they suddenly found themselves at the South Pole. The few remaining in other parts of the world were slaughtered by the more numerous remnants of the human race. Note, there are vague sources who tell of rumors that scientists, in an almost similar scenario as given in the movie The Thing, discovered some reptilian hominoids at the South Pole under the ice pack in a state of suspended animation, that some of these were revived and disaster resulted, although the accounts weren't specific. Because of the fact that almost no documentation of the incident at all has appeared to mainstream ufologists suggests that this particular story might be a hoax. Branton. The blonde, blue-eyed Gobians. The blonde, blue-eyed Gobians were the only group of humans to survive in large numbers, and Doriel's story of their subsequent career gives us suspicions about what the name Great White Brotherhood really meant. He wrote that the wisest of the Gobians journeyed first to Atlantis, where they grew great in knowledge and power. They later fled the sinking of the continent to establish the mystery schools of ancient Egypt. They also became, he wrote, the priests of the Jews. To the ancients, he continued, the Gobians were known as Hebrews, not Jews. The Hebrews were fair-skinned, blue-eyed and red-haired. Of such was the line of David, of such was Solomon, of such was Moses and of such was Jesus who became the Christ. Jesus was not of the Jewish race. There will, unfortunately, Captain Minkle states, Branton, be more of this sort of anti-Semitic occultism in the chapters to come. Note, of course there is more than one genealogy in the New Testament linking Jesus of Nazareth with King David's Jewish lineage, both through Mary and Joseph, indicating that the Son of God was also the legal Son of Man, legally descended from Abraham. Whether Abraham's ancestors were Gobians is difficult to say, However, one must realize that in the face of the grand deception, many actual facts from human sources inevitably lose much of their purity when they finally reach modern man after having passed through ancient occult societies and such. Doriel's own organization included, who tended to bend the historical facts in favor of their own peculiar spiritual or political belief systems in a type of mixture between self-contradicting historical facts and allegorical mythology, or allowed these histories to be corrupted by psychically channeled negative paraphysical know-it-alls who had their own agenda for the human race, which included more than a little propaganda. Virulent lies such as the claim that the serpent race genetically created the human race and therefore humanity must give up, bow down, and worship them as gods. One should realize that when eating meat, whether of the physical, intellectual or spiritual variety, one must learn how to eat the meat and spit out the bones. One should not completely disregard every detail of such accounts, even when they come from occultic sources which have been passed down and corrupted over the centuries, but instead search for the weavings of truth which are mixed in with the threads of error. The truth, naturally, will not contradict itself in any way whatsoever, and this is the key to discerning fact from fiction. Branton, the other white Gabians remained in their homeland until there came an influx of barbarous races from the Mongolian countries, causing them to abandon the Gobi and migrate to Scandinavia, the so-called Nordics, Branton, where they have remained to this day. Blue race. Doriel noted that while most of the other races of the world today are admixtures of many races, the Scandinavians are one of the few remaining pure races. But he also revealed the existence of more races, of undreamed of colors, dwelling inside the earth. One of them was the blue race, which had once lived in Atlantis, but moved underground when that continent began sinking. For thousands of years, said Doriel, they have inhabited an enormous maze of caverns honeycombing the entire planet. The blue race, Doriel warned, are deadly serious about their work and are not to be trifled with. He cited the case of Floyd Collins, the doomed spelunker who died after being trapped for weeks in a limestone cavern in Kentucky in 1925. A rescue party kept Collins alive by handing food to him through a hole in the collapsed cavern, but they were never able to free him. Doriel reported that Collins' first words when they reached the spot where he was trapped were, "I have seen the most wonderful things that man has ever dreamed of. I have seen something that the world would not dream of unless they saw it themselves." These were not Collins's actual first words when found. According to the most reliable sources, they were "help me," or something very similar. Captain Minkle, the rescuers asked Collins what he saw, Doriel continued, but he refused to tell them until he was released. What did Collins see? "That cavern," said Doriel, "was one of the entrances to the cave world inhabited by the blue race. The blue folk had no desire to harm him, but knowledge of their secret was inviolate." Collins promised not to reveal what he had seen, but when he got almost to the surface he changed his mind, and when he changed his mind the rock closed in on him. Why? "Because that race has mastery of the rock and of metals and of the earth." Doriel amassed one of the world's largest and finest occult and science fiction libraries, over 30,000 volumes, but all he seemed to distill out of his studies was a long series of repetitive and poorly written, but highly imaginative, booklets on occult subjects, written between about 1940 and his death in 1963. There's a nice brief discussion of Doriel in Syracuse University political scientist and conspiracy theory researcher Michael Barkun's A Culture of Conspiracy, Apocalyptic Visions in Contemporary America, University of California Press. Barkun described him as one of the main inventors or at least popularizers of the myth of the malevolent underground serpent people circulated among some occult or New Age-oriented right-wing conspiracy theorists, a myth Barkun saw as inspired by some of Lovecraft's, Robert E. Howard's, and Clark Ashton Smith's stories. Doggins, Doriel, fearful of nuclear attack, moved his Brotherhood of the White Temple, largely inspired by Guy and Edna Ballard's 1930s Great I Am Cult, to a rock-bound valley near Sedalia, Colorado in the late 1940s or early 1950s. He achieved local notoriety with his prediction that a nuclear war would break out in 1953, from which he expected to be protected by the mountain walls surrounding his community, a sort of forerunner of Elizabeth Clare Prophet, so to speak. I remember Doriel's full-page ads for his booklets in Fate magazine in the 1950s and 1960s. The Essence of the Hefferlin Manuscript, according to Bart Kuhn, was eventually published in a 1960 pamphlet directed at New Age readers. Doriel himself expanded his theory of hidden shape-shifting serpent people among us in the Emerald Tablets. In his 1951 book /Agarda/, Robert Ernst Dickhoff, Sungma Red Lama of the Dorje Lutra Lamasery at his New York City occult bookshop, cited the Emerald Tablets though without mentioning Doriel by name, also writing about humanoid serpent men from Venus exploiting an ancient tunnel system to infiltrate and capture Atlantis and Lemuria. Survivors of the sunken continents escaped to underground hideouts in Agarda and the underground Antarctic Rainbow City. Doriel, Hefferlin, and Dickhoff, according to Bart Kuhn, were the original inspiration of the underground reptilian alien bases at Dulles on Emm and elsewhere that began circulating in UFO buff circles in the 1980s. It was clear that by the early 1950s, the pieces were being put together in a manner that would make them available to the Dulles writers nearly 40 years later. By the time underground alien installation base reports began appearing in the late 1980s, the fictional scenario of reptoids, presented as fact by occultists like Dickhoff, was available, fully formed. One early 1950s pop culture echo of Doriel, Hefferlin, and Dickhoff that I still vividly remember owns like American anthropologist or archaeologist named Ross Lanning, who discovers a bunch of greenish-skinned reptilian humanoid aliens in suspended animation in an underground laboratory in a cavern beneath a South American mountain. Professor Lanning inadvertently revives the reptoid aliens, who flew off in saucer-shaped craft to explore and reconnoiter the Earth of our own day, thus foisting the flying saucer mystery on 20th-century humanity. When Lanning returns to the South American cavern laboratory a few years later, he is met by the aliens, who explain that they are the last survivors of the prehistoric pre-human masters of Earth millions or billions of years ago, who destroyed their civilization in an atomic war. The aliens tell Lanning that they are about to leave Earth to its new masters and fly off into space to look for possible kin of themselves on the other planets of our solar system. Now, the /flying saucers/reptile men encountered by Professor Lanning were not particularly hostile or malevolent, and were in suspended animation in an underground cavern below South America rather than Antarctica, but hey, clearly seem an echo of the fantasies of Doriel, Hefferlin, and Dickhoff.